1 Peter chapter 1. Peter opens his letter. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. This is the word of God. Imagine with me this afternoon, sometime this afternoon, unannounced, unbeknownst to you, a gang of government officials, a street gang of hooligans show up at your house, kick you out of your house, give you 5 minutes to gather whatever it is you can carry on your back, and you're gone. Maybe they give you a wheelbarrow, and you can take your wheelbarrow with you. You have 5 minutes to get out of your house. No advance notice, only what you can carry. Where would you go? To church? You're going to come to me? Yikes. I have one spare bedroom. What would you eat tomorrow? And the next day? And next week? How long could you stay where you stayed? A year from now, where would you be? How would life go for you if you were forcibly removed from your home today? Would that shape the rest of your life? Would it? Yeah, that's something that's hard to come back from. And even if things go well, it's going to be years, and you will never forget the pain, the uncertainty, the heartache, the things left behind, the relationships abandoned. According to the UN Council for Refugees, the reality that I just described is true for 110 million people around the world today. That's not a small number. That's twice the population of this country. People living in refugee camps, people displaced, people fleeing for their lives. But not only is that the reality for millions of people today, this has been the reality for God's people throughout history. I mean, we have a word for such an event. It's called the diaspora. Right? When people are scattered. The word is a Greek word. It literally means to be sown abroad, like the old-fashioned farmers would sow their seed. And what the image pictures is when the Hebrew people in 721 BC and then again in 586 BC, when Assyria came in and took the northern kingdoms, and then Babylon came in and took the southern kingdom, northern tribes scattered to the wind, southern kingdom taken to Babylon, of which only a tiny remnant returned. And we use that word today. There's an Ethiopian diaspora, there's a Nigerian diaspora, there's a Syrian diaspora, there's a Chinese diaspora. This idea of people scattered, and it all goes back to the original diaspora of God's people. But that wasn't the only time. Maybe that was the most formative, but there's a Roman invasion of Jerusalem in 70 AD, in which millions of Jews again were scattered to the wind. And then moving on through history, it happened dozens of times. The Spanish Inquisition, you've heard of the Spanish Inquisition? It displaced 200,000 Jews from their homeland in Spain to who knows where. 200,000 people, that's not a small number. The Russian pogroms. Do you know about the Russian pogroms? Where gangs, just street gangs of within the community, would come against a Jewish community, rape, murder, burn their homes. This is pictured in The Fiddler on the Roof. You've seen the movie, read the book. It is estimated that, and that was just barely over 100 years ago, it is estimated that 250,000 Jews were murdered and an additional 500,000 fled, were displaced. Early 1900s. And that's to say nothing of the Holocaust. 6 million Jews systematically exterminated for no reason other than they were Jews. How do those events shape a people group? How does that trauma, generation by generation, change the way you view life? Would those be formative events? How would that shape you? Not only the Jews, but the early church. Turn with me quickly to Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. You have to see this. I need to hear pages turning, people. Thank you. We need to be in the Word. Don't take my word for it. This is the early church. Jesus had said, "You will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth." The early church started in Jerusalem, and they essentially were staying in Jerusalem. They weren't spreading to the ends of the earth. And a famous man, you might know him by the name of Paul, begins persecuting the church. And it is that persecution that forced them out of Jerusalem into Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. And here it says, Acts chapter 8, verse 1, it says, "Saul approved of Stephen's execution. And that day there arose a great persecution against the church." Mind you, this is months, mere months after Jesus rose from the dead. And immediately the persecution begins against the church. And it says they were scattered. They were exiled throughout the regions of Judea, Samaria, except the apostles. They stayed in Jerusalem. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church, entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Do you not see what's happening here? This is what I just described. If that happened to you, how would you respond? The early church was forced with this decision. How do I respond? How do I respond when I'm forcibly removed from my home? Turn to Hebrews chapter 10. This, again, to me, is one of the most mind-blowing and perhaps to me, if I'm honest with myself, one of the most unrelatable verses in the Bible. Listen to Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 32. The writer of Hebrews says, "Call to mind the former days when, after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with suffering, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, sometimes being partners with those who are so treated." Listen to verse 34. "You had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property." Do you see why I say I don't know that that's relatable to me? How would you accept it if you were forcibly removed from your home? Would you say, "Praise Jesus, amen, hallelujah"? But these believers, early Christians, he says, "You joyfully accepted the plundering of your property." Why? "Since you knew that you yourselves have a better possession than the temporary property of this earth, you yourselves have an eternal inheritance." This changes our perspective. This is what we saw last week. The resurrection of Jesus could change Peter's perspective when he evaluates the question, "Is Jesus worthy of my life? Is Jesus worthy of my pain? Is Jesus worthy of my suffering? Is Jesus worthy of everything?" The resurrection says, "Yes, he is." because we now share in that resurrection. This is the early church. This is the people of God. Even today, Bangladesh, China, Ukraine, Syria, northern Nigeria, Christians are being systematically displaced merely for confessing Jesus as Lord. How would this shape you if that happened here, if that happened to you? I submit to you, it would be a formative event that would shape the rest of your life. It certainly shaped the scriptures. Did you know? Scripture employs various themes to tell and advance the story. And one of the major themes of Scripture is exile. The entire Hebrew Scriptures are a product of exile. Let me tell you what I mean by that. We all know where exile started, right? Not here. This is Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. You see Israel, Jerusalem down here. And what happened from the persecution, the people fled. A few fled into Egypt, and there was a Christian population in Alexandria. But the vast majority of the Christians spread northward, 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 up until this region up here. And by the time Peter writes this letter, it's about 30 years after the resurrection of Jesus, give or take. And by these 30 years, there's a significant Christian population of both Jews and Gentiles in this region. And these are the people to whom Peter is writing. Some people have proposed that Peter's only writing to the Jews so it doesn't apply to us. That's heresy. Don't believe such nonsense. The evidence of the text makes it very clear. Peter is writing to both Jews and Gentile believers in Jesus Christ. But this theme, this idea of exile shaping all of Scripture, it starts in the very first chapters of the Bible. Do you remember? When everything went wrong, Genesis chapter 3. And you know the story, they ate the fruit, God confronts them, there's the interaction between God and the serpent, and wherein God pronounces the gospel and says the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. But then he goes on to pronounce over woman and over man that life is going to be hard. Because now you've rejected me, so now you no longer have access to my garden. And at the end of Genesis chapter 3, we read this. He drove out the man, that's exile, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. Mankind was kicked out of our Edenic home, out of our paradise home, out of the garden of God. We were kicked out, exiled to the east. And that exile to the east continues throughout the scriptures. It culminates when all humanity is exiled by the confusion of their languages and scattered from the Near East, from Mesopotamia, scattered around the world in Genesis chapter 11. But Genesis chapter 12 comes around, and here's what happens. God calls a man who lives in the east to get up and to move to the land which he will show him. What's this man's name? Abraham. Thank you. He calls Abraham to be an exile. Abraham lives in the east and he says, get up, leave your home. I'll give you a new home. I'll show you. And so Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, the Hebrews in Egypt, and the story of exile continues all throughout the Old Testament. In fact, look with me, just turn back, probably in your Bible, two pages. You might still be in Hebrews. If you're still in Hebrews, it's one page over. Hebrews chapter 11, right? God's hall of faith. And in this, the writer of Hebrews is reflecting upon Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and of course, Jacob's children. And listen to what he says. Okay, so Abraham is now in exile. God has called him to leave his home. So now it's not a forcible exile with a flaming cherubim sword. Now it's a call. It's a voluntary exile. Follow me. God says to Abraham, I'll show you the land. So Abraham gets up and leaves, and he voluntarily goes into exile. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out, there it is, exile, to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith he went to live in the land of promise as in a foreign land, living in tents. That's a refugee. Living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. Why? Because he was looking forward to a city, not a tent, a city that has foundations whose designer and builder is God. Skip down to verse 13. Listen to what it says about Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. Verse 13, all these died in faith, not having received the promises. What? God promised Abraham, I'll give you all the land that you can see, all the land that your feet tread upon. I will give that to you as your inheritance. And Abraham dies living in a tent, and the only land that he owned was a burial plot for his wife. He died not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that he was a stranger and an exile on earth. For people who think in this way, who speak in this way, make it clear that they are seeking a homeland, but not an earthly homeland, a heavenly one. So the fathers of our faith go into exile. And then the history continues. Let's do a whirlwind trip through the Old Testament. Joseph gets sent into exile in Egypt in order to save the very ones who put him in exile in Egypt. And through that, all the people of God come into exile in Egypt. 400 years pass, they become slaves. We know the story, right? And God raises up a deliverer, Moses, and brings them out of exile to a mountain where he constitutes his people. He gives them a covenant and he renews the promise to give them the land. And then they go on a journey to the land. And in the covenant, God said, I'll bring you into the land. And if you keep my covenant, I will keep you in the land forever and ever. Amen. But if you violate my covenant, I'll send one punishment so you repent. If you don't repent, I'll send the next punishment so that you repent. And if you don't repent, I'll send the next. This is the mercy of God. If you keep the covenant, you get all the blessings part and parcel at once. If you reject the covenant of God, he slowly brings the punishments one after the next to call you to repent. But he says, if you refuse after all those punishments to repent, if you refuse, I will delight to kick you out of the land. Did you hear what God said? I will delight to kick you out of the land. Church, we have to take a picture of God as he explains himself. And for God to say in that moment, I will gladly kick you out of my land. And then he brings them into the land, Joshua. They inherit the land. The judges, dark period in history. Ruth, time goes on. David comes on the scene, expands the kingdom. Solomon even further. But it doesn't go well after Solomon. The kingdom splits. You have the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom. And both kingdoms, God sends them prophets saying, repent, judgment is coming. Repent, judgment is coming. Repent, judgment is coming. How does that compare to the message of our so-called prophets today, by the way? Are they proclaiming, repent, judgment is coming? No. That's not what the so-called prophets of today are doing. They're preaching a different message altogether. And hundreds of years pass, dynasties come and go in the northern kingdom. And finally God says, you know, I'm done. I sent you my covenant. You violated. You did not listen to my prophets. You killed my prophets, so I'm kicking you out of the land. And he does so in 721 BC. Now, he tells the southern kingdom, take note of your sister. This is what happens. This is what happens when you disregard my covenant. And, of course, they continue killing the prophets and disregarding the covenant until a king named Josiah comes on the scene. 2 Kings chapter 22. What does Josiah do? He becomes king at a very young age. I believe he was 7 years old when he became king. And he says, we need, he looked at the temple, he said, it's in disrepair, it's not clean, it's falling apart. We need to clean out the temple. And so he commissions a crew to go in and clean out the temple of God. And what do they find in the rubbish pile of the temple? The word of God, the covenant law of God. That's how neglected it had been. One of the rules, the king was supposed to handwrite a copy of the covenant law and keep it with him on the throne. Josiah gets this covenant law. They bring it to him. And they're like, look what we found. This seems important. And Josiah reads it and he says, oh my goodness, we are in so much trouble. We are doomed. And he brings about a great revival, a great repentance. And God says, Josiah, for your sake, I will hold off judging these people until you die. But judgment is coming. So Josiah passes away in battle. And his sons, now it becomes a game of thrones. Babylon comes in. And God raises up a prophet. What's his name? Jeremiah. God raises up Jeremiah to proclaim, judgment is coming. Babylon's coming. It's no longer an if, it's a when. But meanwhile, there's other prophets in Jeremiah's day. All right, you don't have to turn here if you don't want to. I'm turning to Jeremiah 23. In Jeremiah 23, the kings are not listening to Jeremiah. They're like, who's this guy? He's speaking nonsense. I don't really like what he says, so somebody shut him up. And meanwhile, there's other prophets proclaiming, and here's what the prophets are proclaiming. This is what Jeremiah writes. He says, thus says Yahweh of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you, filling you with empty hope. They speak visions of their own mind, not from the mouth of Yahweh. They say continually to those who despise the word of Yahweh, it will be well with you, peace, prosperity, success. And to everyone who stubbornly follows his own heart, they say, no disaster shall come upon you. You're fine. You're fine. God loves you. God affirms you. Jesus accepts everyone the way they are. No repentance. No wrath of God. That's not the gospel. God says, I did not send these prophets, but they ran to you. I did not speak to them, yet they prophesied. But had they stood in my presence, they would have proclaimed my words to the people. And listen to what he says. He says, a prophet who has a dream can tell his dream, but the one who has my word must proclaim my word. And our churches today are filled with false prophets, proclaiming peace, safety, affirmation. You're fine. You don't need to repent. You just plant your seed. God will bring you a harvest, A, B, C, and D. That is rubbish. That is not the message of God. And when we do such a thing, we are proclaiming a gospel of damnation. And so, Church, Welcome Baptist, we reject any such gospel that affirms humanity in their own heart without calling them to repent and receive a new heart. God sends his people into exile. But do you know what happened? Exile restored the scriptures. Because for all those years, they thought God was a barking dog. Yep, 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 yep. Sends the prophets. Yep, 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 yep. He's never going to bite me. And then they got bitten. That shaped them. We talked earlier in the introduction, Psalm 137, smashing babies on rocks. That shapes a man. And so they went through this. They went through the exile. After about 70 years, a small remnant returns. And that remnant says, we've got to take God's word seriously. He means it when he says something. And so that is when the Hebrew scriptures were compiled. That's when they brought all of this together and said, we're going to make this a collection. We're going to take this seriously. And they began taking it seriously. In fact, so seriously that they began adding things to the Word of God, which is another error altogether. And that's who the Pharisees were by the time Jesus came on the scene, is those who had added to the Word of God, thinking, I'm taking God's Word so seriously, let me put some more things on top of it. As if God's Word is so easy to keep, right? But here's what God does. He sent them into exile. But even in his covenant, he said, if in exile you cry to me, I will not abandon you. If you cry and repent, I'll bring you back. And he brought them back. And here's what our God does. God uses pain, even the pain of exile, to shape his people. Here's what C.S. Lewis says in his book, Problem of Pain. God whispers to us in our pleasures. He speaks to us in our conscience, but he shouts in our pain. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. You are probably carrying the pain of being in exile. I find it hard to believe that there's anyone in this room who is not carrying some scars from living a life outside of the presence of God, outside of Eden. And perhaps God is shouting at you in your pain today. Church, have we forgotten that we are exiles? Because a renter cares for a house differently than the homeowner, right? We are called as exiles. We don't own the home. We are east of Eden. And the reality is, pain and death is ours. I read a quote from John Piper that impacted me. He said, "One of my duties as your pastor is to preach and to pray in such a way that you are prepared in mind and in heart not to curse God in the day of your calamity. But even more, that instead of cursing, you might worship God and bless him as your free and sovereign Father, no matter how intense the grief or deep the pain that he brings into your life." We asked the question last week, does God have the right to do whatever he wants with my life? Does he have that right? He's God. He's the potter. I'm the clay. I have no right to say, why did you make me this way? And Peter reminds us that we are all exiles. And we're reminded ourselves that Peter's talk is not cheap. When he writes this letter, this is 30 years after him answering that call, is Jesus worth it? And we see in this letter, his answer is yes, Jesus is worth it. This is not cheap talk when Peter is saying this, because he still has imminent crucifixion hanging over his head. And what he does in this book is he develops themes. He introduces it by saying to the elect exiles. And he develops themes that come up in the Christian life, in the life of the exile. Themes of trial, themes of suffering. He calls it a fiery trial that's coming. Themes of hope, themes of faith, themes of your witness, your testimony, themes of brotherhood, themes of your conduct. In fact, the theme of 1 Peter could be summarized, how then should we live? If Jesus is who he says he is, how then should we live? How do exiles live? Some of you in this church can relate. We actually have a fair number of expats in this church, right? From different backgrounds, different communities, Americans, Nigerians, British people. No offense, Sarah. I'm aiming that at Joshua. I think you all know that. We have all different backgrounds. Life as an exile can be complicated. Amen? Those of you who have never lived in a foreign country, it's hard to explain. It really is. Speak to Josh and Esther. Speak to some of the other exiles among us. It's complicated. Paperwork, documentation. It's uncertain. It can be unsafe. It can be difficult. It can be painful. But Peter doesn't just say, I'm writing to exiles. Listen to what Peter says. Again, a mind-blowing statement of the reality of the Christian life. In the ESV, you might have a different translation, but all of them tie together these two words, elect exiles. Elect exiles. Ooh, doctrine of election. No, no, don't go there. Elect exiles. Now, this raises some questions in my mind. What is the nature of this union between election and exile? Are you following with me? Are you tracking? Because the reality is we're exiles. All humanity outside of Eden, we're all exiles, yes. But Peter's not just speaking to those, he's speaking to Christians, the unique exile that belongs to Christians. And he says, elect exiles from Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. So these exiles, is Peter saying they are elected from the exile? As in, they are elected from the exile that all humanity participates in? Is he saying they are elect in their exile? In other words, yes, you're in exile, but you're elect, so it's okay. Or is he saying that you have been elected to exile? That means something altogether different, does it not? God, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, the Alpha and the Omega, the one for whom and by whom all things consist, has chosen that his people would be exiles. And the life of an exile hurts. God chose that life for me? I thought Jesus loves the little children. What kind of God is this? Well, I'm glad you asked. What kind of God is this? Because if we want to understand the reality of the nature of our life, we have to understand exile. So the question, I believe, that is posed by the text, how are God's people shaped by exile? Exile, a formative event. How are God's people shaped by exile? Look at verse 2. It says, you are an elect exile, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling with his blood. You realize he just invoked the entire triune Godhead. The triune Godhead is brought to bear on your life as an exile. This sounds like Paul's statement in Ephesians chapter 1, where the entire triune Godhead is participating in ensuring our salvation. But here, the entire triune Godhead is relating to us in our exile. How does God shape us by exile? Number one, we have been elected according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. That deepens our appreciation for God's love. Let me explain. That word foreknowledge is not like God intellectually considered you before the foundation of the world. It means he intellectually chose a relationship with you before the foundation of the world. Foreknowledge might be better translated foreloved. You are an exile because of the eternal love of God with which he loved you before the foundation of the world. It doesn't always feel that way in exile, though, does it? The pain of exile doesn't feel like God loves us. But when you live in exile, you begin to value and gain a deeper appreciation of and a deeper knowledge yourself of the love of God. Let me try to illustrate this point. Most of you know we're dealing with visa issues as a family ourselves. 2 years expired, waiting on certain government entities to process paperwork. South Africa has perfected the art of standing in line, right? The Republic of Queues. Just this week, we spent 4-6 hours just trying to get our fingerprints for a background check. Over two days, we had to come and go. You know how it is. You experience the same frustration, but here's what happens. A few weeks ago, we had to go renew our family's passports at the U.S. consulate in Johannesburg. And we had booked appointments, but you know how government appointments are. They aren't always on time. We were on time. We were early. So we show up, we park at the Sandton City shopping complex, we cross the road, and already it's 7:45, and there's probably 60 people in line in front of us. So we get in line to enter the U.S. consulate, and a staff member is going down the line, checking, you know, what are you here for? Do you have an appointment? What's your paperwork? All of that. She gets to us, and she sees, oh, American citizens, come with me. She walks us right past that entire line of 60 people, puts us right in front of the security doors. As soon as those doors open, she escorts us in through security. There's another building behind that, brings us to that building. That's an L-shaped building. This side over there is for all the South Africans. This side over here, Americans. And she escorts us right to some seats and says, have a seat, we'll be right with you. Everybody else still standing outside, still standing in line. There's a lot of things I don't like about America right now. But I can tell you, in that moment, I felt valued. I felt, God bless America. And when we live as exiles, the challenges of all the lines that we have to stand in make us appreciate now this citizenship. Our citizenship is in heaven. You don't have to stand in line to get there. We get to go directly to the very throne room of God and lay our requests out. But we won't do that when life is easy, will we? Because God is whispering to us in our pleasure, and we're like, shh, God, quiet, I like the pleasure. But in our pain, he gets our attention. And suddenly we begin to appreciate the value of being able to kneel at that throne and say, God, this is what I need from you right now. And so it develops our appreciation. There is an example of this in Scripture. Abraham, the father of our faith, we mentioned him. He was called as an exile. Couldn't God have said, Abraham, I'm going to make a great nation out of you. Just chill, relax in Ur of the Chaldees. You'll be fine. I'll take care of it from here. Couldn't God have said that? Couldn't God have left him in Haran? Why did God say, Abraham, get up and leave your home? Because God couldn't make Abraham great in his homeland? Or were there no old people with old wives in Canaan that God could have picked? Make this very clear in your head. God did not pick Abraham because Abraham was a great guy. God divinely elected Abraham out of paganism to be his man. Abraham did not earn it. God chose Abraham, but in his choosing of Abraham, he said, Abraham, you have to leave. You have to become an exile. Why? Because Abraham, I need you to learn who I am. And when your life is comfortable, when your life is easy, when your life is smooth, you will never plumb the depths of the glorious love of God. But when life hurts, even the smallest love of God, the smallest relief in that moment is precious and delightful. Amen? And so God leads Abraham. And Abraham goes from knowing God to knowing Yahweh. We learn things. We learn things in pain. Abraham learned things. He learned that God is trustworthy, right? Abraham learned God is trustworthy. But you know what else Abraham learned? Abraham learned to trust God. Those are not the same thing. At Welcome Baptist, we preach big God theology. And all of you say amen, hallelujah, praise God. We preach a big God. A God who declares the beginning from the end. A God who is sovereign over all his creation. But that very same God comes to his people and says, I'm trustworthy. We say, amen, you're trustworthy. And then he says, trust me. You say, well, I don't know if you're that trustworthy. It's not until we are forced into a corner where we must trust God because we have nothing else to depend upon, that we truly learn to trust God. Abraham would never have learned that. He could have learned that God is trustworthy in his homeland, but he never would have learned to trust until he stepped out in that journey of exile and followed God. We learn that God is good. He provides for his own. Refugees are poor. Refugees are needy. Refugees have a lot of felt needs that must be met. And God, in our exile, meets these needs. We learn that he provides. We learn that he is intentional. He's not capricious. He's not zapping us just to see how much it hurts. He is using the pain of exile to accomplish in us better things that we ever could have known or felt without it. Abraham was called by God into a life of exile, not a life of ease. And he never received the promise. But he received something better. God said, I'll give you all of this land. And he died in a tent with God. He was called the friend of God. So what was better, the land or the relationship? Would you rather own thousands of acres of farmland, or would you rather be called the friend of God? Exile did this, and Abraham was forced to answer the question, is God enough? We also learn in exile that our value system has to be changed, has to be transformed. Exile changes our value system. Listen to what it says. We are elect exiles in the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. Second person of the Godhead listed here. And it lists his work of sanctification. Now, we all love the doctrine of justification. If you don't know what I'm talking about, justification is the doctrine whereby God says, you're not guilty for the sins that you committed because Jesus paid for them. That's a glorious doctrine, amen? Not guilty, not guilty, not guilty. That brings peace. That brings joy. That is an eternal declaration, double jeopardy. God will never bring us into trial for our sins that Jesus took upon himself on the cross. Justification is so glorious, and sanctification is equally glorious and tremendously painful. Sanctification is that process whereby God changes you from being a sinner, dead in your sins, to slowly but surely over time as you submit to being made into the image of Jesus Christ. And that word sanctification literally means to set apart. You were born as a descendant of Adam into this world. You're not meant to stay a descendant of Adam as a citizen of this world. You are meant to be transferred into a heavenly kingdom, a heavenly citizenship, and be remade into the image of the second Adam, Jesus Christ. But change is painful and hard because we all kind of love ourselves a lot. A lot. And what Jesus is doing in giving us a new heart is he's saying, your old heart, no good, deceitful above all things and desperately sick. New heart, that is good. Follow the new heart. Follow the new way. Follow the Spirit. And it transforms our worldview. There's an example of this again in Genesis, Jacob. Jacob was an exile. You remember, he was born as a descendant of Abraham in Canaan. And even before his birth, remember, we had this question come up in our Makanio class yesterday. Before his birth, God had declared to Rebekah that you're going to have twins. There's a struggle. The younger one will rule the older one. But what did Jacob do? Was he satisfied just to leave it at that? No, he had to take matters into his own hands. Jacob, oh, wonderful Jacob. And if you know the story, Jacob had to flee because he stole in two different events, manipulation and then deception. He stole the blessing and the birthright from his older brother. His older brother, who is kind of a bad dude, who was very skilled at killing things. So Jacob gets up and he leaves, right? He flees. And one night he's sleeping out in the veldt with a rock for his pillow as he's fleeing. Where was he fleeing, by the way? To the east. He was going into exile to the east. And God meets him and he has a dream. He has a vision where he sees Jesus Christ at the top of the ladder, angels coming and going. And Jesus says to him, Jacob, just like I was with Abraham, just like I was with Isaac, I will be with you. And Jacob says, yeah, if you make sure my shoes don't wear out, then I'll trust you. Jacob, oh, he's so wonderful. Jacob goes into an exile of his own making. How many of us are in an exile of our own making? How many of us are living distant from God when God is saying, draw near to me and I will draw near to you? If you, I've said this before, youth, I've said it to you on Friday night, I will continue to say it. If God feels far away, he didn't move. You moved. So you must turn, submit, and draw near to God. And Jacob goes into exile and he experiences hardship after hardship. He himself is manipulated and deceived for years. But the blessing of God is with him. God is still with him. He still prospers. And God brings him back. And as he's coming back, remember, he's afraid for his life. You know this story, right? He's afraid for his life. Jacob still hasn't changed. And what does he do? Before he meets Esau, Esau's got like 500 men, and Jacob is thinking, he's coming to kill me. He spends a sleepless night where he encounters Jesus, the angel of Yahweh, pre-incarnate Jesus, encounters him and wrestles the whole night for what Jesus had already said, I will give you. And his hip gets put out of place. And he suffers the rest of his life because he was fighting God for what God already said, I'm going to give it to you. But how many of us are living the pain of exile because we're not satisfied with the blessing that God has already given us? We need more. We need to get it now. Yeah, I know I have an eternal inheritance, but I want it now. Who else said that? The prodigal son, right? Give me my inheritance now. And we suffer needless body blows to ourselves. God does not abandon us, no way, no how. But we bring upon ourselves a deeper pain of sanctification in our exile because we are insisting from God that we get the blessing now, and we're not willing to wait until his time is right. And so what exile does is strips away the extra baggage that we carry. It begins to strip away. God says, you don't need that. You don't need that. You don't need that. And the tighter we cling to these things, the more it hurts when God peels our fingers off, and the more God has to peel our fingers off to say, you're not satisfied with me. So I've got to strip these things away, and it will be painful, but just hold your blessings open hand. Just hold them like this. Seek first my kingdom, my righteousness. I will add to you what I say you need. And some of us need to consider what it is that we are carrying, what it is that we are dragging along with us. Is Jesus worth it? If it costs you salary, is Jesus worth it? If it costs your home, is Jesus worth it? If it costs your son or your daughter, is Jesus worth it? And finally, we see in this text the work of Jesus Christ in our exile. The Son of God is brought to bear. Exile deepens our allegiance to the King. It says here, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, you have been made chosen to be an exile. That word obedience is literally to hear under. In other words, to submit, to place yourself under. So this obedience that we are called to swear allegiance to Jesus Christ is an obedience of submission. He's a good and he's a gracious king. But we are called to submit even when we don't understand, even when we disagree. And then it says, and to be sprinkled with his blood. Now, some people have said, oh, there you see, baptism, sprinkling. You know, we use it to justify an invalid method of baptism. The word baptize literally means to immerse. Sprinkle means to sprinkle. He's not talking about baptism here. Do you know what he's talking about? We won't turn there, but in Exodus 24, after God lays out the covenant, the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, and then the case law that follows that, after all of that, Moses calls the people together. They slaughter some animals, and he takes half the blood and he pours it on the altar. He takes the other half of the blood and he puts it in basins. And the whole congregation comes together to hear the words of the covenant, which they have already sworn they will follow. And Moses reads this aloud, and they swear, we abide by the covenant. And Moses takes the blood, and he takes some hyssop, and he sprinkles it on the people. This is an ancient way of signing the T's and C's of the covenant. It's a way of saying, if I violate this covenant, may what was done to that animal be done to me. It's a covenant of blood. An exile brings us more and more deeply into obedience to the covenant of God. Joseph, you know the story, went into exile, sold by his own brothers into exile by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, so that Joseph could be there to save not only Egypt, but his own brothers who had sold him into exile from exile. Don't let this be cheap. He was sold as a slave. In the house of his master, he achieved success, right? Why did he achieve success? You know why? What does the text say? Because Yahweh was with him. Yahweh was with him so well that he was falsely accused of rape and thrown in prison. And he succeeded in prison. Why? Because Yahweh was with him. This is what's repeated over and over in the story of Joseph. Yahweh was with him. I am with you, Joseph. And Joseph continually beaten down, continually rising because Yahweh was with him. Until that ironic reversal when the brothers come, right? Oh, it's so delightful. The Bible is just so good. Joseph, like Jesus, learned obedience through the things that he suffered. And in so doing, saved humanity. And in Joseph's exile, as he's raised to power, he can burn it all to the ground, right? He has the power in his hand, second to Pharaoh, to burn it all to the ground in vengeance. And some of us would say, amen, I can't wait to burn things to the ground. And Joseph says, what you intended for evil, God intended for good. And so then, as exiles, do we say, burn it all to the ground? No. What did Jeremiah say to the exiles? Plant gardens, build houses, give your sons and daughters in marriage, make babies, carry on the next generation. Seek the peace of Babylon. So as exiles, what do? We seek the peace of Velcom, even as Velcom crumbles around us. As exiles, what do? Joseph laid down his life to save his brothers. We have a true and better Joseph, Jesus Christ, who the Son of Heaven, everything was his. The throne belonged to him. The glory of God Almighty that he shared from eternity past was his by birthright. And he let it go. He did not consider it something to be grasped, but he made himself of no reputation, took upon himself the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men. He was exiled from the glories of heaven, and the angel said, you're doing what? To them? We'll see that as we explore the rest of this chapter later on. Our Savior went into exile voluntarily to save his brothers in exile. He laid down his life. He took it back up. And he ascended to the right hand of God Almighty. And as he ascended, he said to his followers, go, be exiles. Voluntarily lay down your life into all the world. Preach the gospel, and I am with you. This is the upside-down call of the gospel. We win by losing. We gain heaven and earth by giving up earth. We are called to be exiles. Earlier this week, and I'll close with this, earlier this week, I had a young person send me a message, a new convert, and she says, what should Christians think of Orania? Now, for those of you who don't know Orania, it's a small town in the Northern Cape in South Africa that has established itself as an Afrikaner community. Only Afrikaans. And this is a touchy subject for a lot of people, right? There's a lot of history under that bridge. How should a Christian view Orania? I thought about it. I'm like, is she trying to trap me? No. How should we view Orania? On the one hand, I get it. In all of humanity, there is a desire for Eden. We long for Eden. We want a place that is peaceful and quiet and where we share the same language. Remember, confused language was a punishment. Where we share a similar culture, a similar worldview, a similar religion. That is in the heart of every single human being. I get the attraction of a place like Orania. But for the people of God, that's not what we are called to do. We're not called to make compounds and isolate ourselves from the rest of the world. We are called to go into exile voluntarily, lay down our lives voluntarily, go to every tribe and tongue and nation and language voluntarily. The Moravian missionaries of the 1800s, perhaps the greatest missions movement the world has ever seen. There were two Moravian missionaries who wanted to minister to the slaves on the Caribbean islands, sugarcane fields and whatnot, particularly the island of Jamaica. But the governor of Jamaica banned them from coming to the island because if we preach the gospel to slaves, slaves will be set free and they'll be getting ideas that we don't want them to have. So we can't have the gospel on this island. So do you know what these two missionaries did? They sold themselves into slavery to get onto the island so they could preach the gospel to the slaves on the island. And as they boarded the ship to leave, as they waved goodbye, the cry from their lips was the cry of the Moravian missionary movement, which was, "May the Lamb who is slain receive the reward of his suffering." Let's be honest with ourselves. Welcome is not worth laying down my life. But Jesus is worth laying down my life. And by the grace of God, Jesus has people in this community of his family who have not yet confessed him. And so we lay down our lives. Church, we willingly embrace exile, because we have the entire power of the triune Godhead brought to bear to sustain us, to shape us, to mold us, to satisfy us. So I challenge you again. Have you forgotten that you're in exile? Are there things that you are building that are not seeking the peace of Babylon and not seeking the peace of God's people? Are there things that you need to chuck out of the wagon because they're weighing you down? Some of you are still in exile, not the voluntary exile, but that East of Eden exile. You've never submitted to Jesus Christ. The question posed to Peter, "Is Jesus worth it?" remains to you and me today. Is Jesus worth it? Only you can answer that between you and God. Let's pray. Our Father, we confess our exile and we confess our longing for you. Satisfy us with your presence. Humble us to submission. May the Lamb who is slain receive the reward of his suffering. We pray this in his name. Amen. Amen.